Hey everyone, Adam Shaw here from Bravura Media Company. Today we're going to be talking about the patron saint of Ireland, Saint Patrick. We're going to be going over his history, his biography. We're going to be looking at various visual elements depicting his influence of Christianity on Ireland. And we're really doing this video in connection with our Irish history, Irish cultural series pertaining to upcoming St. Patrick's Day. We like doing historical videos on current events and holidays. If you like that sort of thing, definitely subscribe to us. We like talking about history and tying it all together to make this channel fun. So, without further ado, let's get to it. Right in front of you, we have a vintage postcard of a young St. Patrick. This postcard was produced in 1910. It gives off certain elements of Celtic culture, certainly with the Shamrocks. To get into the history of St. Patrick, St. Patrick was a 5th century Christian missionary and bishop of Ireland. He was regarded, as we said before, as the patron saint of Ireland because of his massive converting of Celtic polytheism believers into Christians. He has been regarded as the primary historical source of Christian influence by the church, but archaeologists are now discovering that there were essentially Christian influence before his arrival via Irish pirates bringing back missionaries, slaves, and merchants, people who essentially had Christian faith. So there was a Christian element even before St. Patrick arrived. St. Patrick was eventually amongst those captured by Irish pirates at a young age. According to the Confessio of Patrick, he was about 16 when he was captured, and then he was taken as a slave. While in Ireland, he tended to the animals on a farm and eventually escaped 6 years later, returning back to his family in Britain. He then became a cleric and eventually returned back to Ireland in the northern and western regions by the 17th century. After he became a massive Christian influence, he was revered, as we said before, the patron saint of Ireland. St. Patrick's Day is celebrated on March 17th because people, for the most part, believe that was the date of his death. While he was enslaved, this is kind of interesting, while he was enslaved and captive by Irish pirates, this really contributed to the beginning steps of his faith conversion into Christianity. According to his written confessions, he explained that the Lord had mercy on his youth and ignorance and afforded him the opportunity to be forgiven of his sins, and he converted to Christianity. While Patrick, as we said before, while he was captive, he tended as a shepherd, and he prayed to God, and this strengthened his relationship with religion and his ability to convert. We're going to show you some different visual examples of his capturing by Irish pirates. We're going to show you some Irish pirates. Let's go down to our images. This is a depiction of Irish pirates. It was produced in 1910, but you can see that these Celtic pirates kind of gave off the Viking look and style, especially with their boats and the shields on the ends of boats. Very, very interesting perspective here. If we go, this is a book. We talked about St. Patrick tending to animals on a farm. We can see it right here. Animals in the background, they called it, you know, he was referred to as a shepherd, his shepherd stick, and we can see the halo above his head. This is a book that you can actually, if you'd like to search online, The Life of St. Patrick. I believe it's freely, you can freely download this online from archive.org. It might even be on Project Gutenberg, but I know the book's free, and it's got some great artwork in it. So feel free to go find that book and download it for free. But here's an example, and we can see of the authorities, The Life of St. Patrick. We can even see, I've got a picture of him being captured by pirates. You see these boats? Remember we said those Irish pirates? Man, they look like Normans. I mean, it's almost identical. And, you know, we can see him being taken right here by the Irish pirates as a young boy. I love this artwork. This is from the book, The Life of St. Patrick. The book, I believe, was produced in 1899. So definitely check that out. Let's go further into the history. So he was essentially a slave, and he was tending to a flock of animals and praying. Oh, let me move this over. He was praying a lot, which helped his conversion. 6 years into his enslavement, St. Patrick actually heard, he told himself that he heard a voice telling him that he would soon go home and that his ship was ready. So eventually he decided, well, I'm going to flee my master. He traveled to a port 200 miles away where he found a ship, and with immense amounts of tenacity, he persuaded a captain to take him back to Britain. He convinced this guy to go back to Britain. After 3 days of sailing, they arrived in Britain and abandoned the ship and began walking for 28 days in the wilderness. They were essentially scavenging for supplies and food. That's what people believe. The crew and Patrick were on the verge of starvation, for which Patrick took to prayer and asked God for sustenance. After his prayer, the crew encountered a herd of wild boar. Since this was shortly after Patrick told them to put their faith in God, his prestige in the group they became believers. Eventually, after various adventures, Patrick would return home in his early 20s and would continue his study of the Christian faith. Patrick's return to Ireland some years later is recounted in his writings when he describes having a vision, which he states. Let's see if we can kind of also go over. Here's another example of St. Patrick holding a clover. I saw a man coming, as it were, from Ireland. His name was Victorious, and he carried many letters and gave me one of them. I read the heading, The Voice of the Irish. As I began the letter, I imagined in that moment that I heard the voice of the very people who were near the wood of Falkirk, which is beside the Western Sea. And they cried out, as with one voice, We appeal to you, holy servant boy, to come and walk among us. So essentially, he heard this voice essentially saying, you need to come help the Irish people. The Irish people need assistance. They need guidance. Patrick then decided to act on his vision and return to Ireland as a Christian missionary. His landing place, based on research, seems to be Wicklow, Ireland, at the mouth of the Inverter River, what we know now as the Verite River. And I can actually show you where that is. We have a map. Okay, so Wicklow is right here. You can see Wicklow, and we can see the Verite River. So right here, this is where St. Patrick came back into port, right about here. It's south of Dublin, not too far outside of Dublin, right here. And so his landing place was based in Wicklow, Ireland. Research now suggests, this is kind of interesting, that this is the place he escaped from, the port that he escaped. Remember we talked about he convinced a captain of a ship to escape Ireland? So he traveled about 200 miles throughout Ireland all the way to Wicklow, to right here, and escaped. And then he returned through port, through right here. Probably because he knew the lay of the land, kind of. Legend has it that St. Patrick taught the native pagan Irish about the Holy Trinity using a shamrock. This is, okay, now we're getting into some good stuff. Okay. A lot of artwork depicting St. Patrick with a three-leafed clover shamrock. So he was essentially teaching the Holy Trinity using a shamrock, using it to illustrate the Christians of the three persons in one God. If you're not familiar with the Holy Trinity, it essentially is the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. You know how you do the cross? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Threes. Pagans were, at the time, very naturesque. They believed in aspects of nature, winter solstices, the seasonal solstices. They believed in nature very heavily. And the shamrock was really a cultural phenomenon. They related to revitalization and kind of revitalization of nature and of life. And what St. Patrick did very well was tie the nature aspect of Celtic polytheism to Christianity. And we see this artwork of him depicting the shamrocks. Here are the shamrocks again. This is this is 1910 artwork, but look, he's holding a shamrock right there. And this is how it got tied together with Christianity and St. Patrick. And we can see the threes. Here's just some artwork of shamrocks. But, you know, very reminiscent of a cross. And I thought that was interesting to share with you guys. It's kind of, you know, he manipulated Celtic polytheism into Christianity. So, you know, just one of the many reasons why we celebrate St. Patrick's Day, you know, because of and the shamrock in green. Green is a predominant element, you know, that probably emanated from the shamrock. So, let's move on to more aspects of this history. We even see, you know, the legend that St. Patrick banished all the snakes from Ireland. We've heard this common term before. Really was a metaphor, a religious metaphor for banishing all out Celtic polytheism or paganism. Because if you look at the Christian church, the snake, right, was a symbol of evil and corruption and sin. And so I want to say that St. Patrick used metaphors very, very well in terms of converting pagans to Christians by kind of creating these elements, because there were no snakes in Ireland back then. And even, this is kind of funny, naturalists are now saying snakes never existed on the island back then. And he used that to his advantage, kind of this mystical nature that everything was banished. The church really utilized this, and he utilized this. So that's kind of a myth that he banished all the snakes out of Ireland. So I thought that was interesting, and I wanted to bring that up as well. So let's look at, this is kind of a basic look at the Celtic polytheism, these monolith essential stones. And look, we've got snakes illustrated. Isn't that ironic that snakes are illustrated on these stones? And also, what I find interesting about this artwork is threes. Because oftentimes, the Celts would celebrate three deities. That's another thing that goes into the Shamrock. Celtic people celebrated, they saw something in three gods. They always celebrated in threes. And certainly we've got a celebration of snakes in threes right here. The Shamrock has three cloves, and the cross has three sides. So very, you know, that it was easy to manipulate the pagans using the threes. And we'll show an illustration of the death of Saint Patrick. We can see that right here. We celebrate Saint Patrick because on the 17th, because it was the date of supposed death. Notice on the sides, shamrocks, right? So a very potent symbol of Celtic, I guess you could say, history and religious history. So I just wanted to share a little bit of background and history to St. Patrick and his converting of the Irish pagans to Christianity. I hope you've learned something from this video. Definitely check out the rest of our channel. We're doing many, many other videos on Celtic pagan culture, on Irish history. And we've done like five different videos, a map of Boston, a map of Ireland, Dublin. We're going to be drinking some Guinness beer. Definitely check out the rest of our channel. Give us a subscribe. And I will see everyone soon. Okay? Take care now. All right, bye.